off to their hotels or caravans, no little souvenirs. And the other people stay in town with most of the mortgages.
And then some caravans.
They enjoy their evening meal in one of the many restaurants, and after that they start drinking in the cafes until closing time at 1 o'clock in the morning. Many of them become roaring drunk, like my friend Ari, for example, about whom he said that once he entered the pig stable, thinking it was his house, lay down beside the pig, thinking it was his wife, and grumbled, "Hell, darling, are you still wearing that old pink nightgown with those two rows of buttons?" I soon found out that such a thing could never happen in England, even though there are pubs and inns. I thought at first that a pub was another word for inn, but I learned that an inn does not want to consider to be a pub, and that a pub is a place with nobody in. But this applies also to a pub. For example, when you are attracted by the sign "morning coffee," you hear that it has nothing to do with the kind of invitation like "morning coffee," but that they are closed now, since a place 100 yards away is open. So why bother? Well, I went to that place and I had my morning coffee. But I love to return to England as soon as possible.
Being an announcer was mostly routine work. Now and again we used to act in plays. My voice being tight, I did not often get deep emotional parts. One day, my big chance came. I was talking to a young teenage girl in 5 minutes in dancing. I put myself in the mood and dressed all in black, inside and out. At the climax of the play, I was to sacrifice my love for the sake of the woman who had adopted me. I knew the part by heart, and it was one day I my eyes shut, carried along the waves of the dramatic impact of the sacrifice I was about to make. The last words were from my father. I looked across the mic, my colleague's face was hidden by her smile, her shoulders were shaking. A quick look at the producer through the glass. In the control room, he was kind of wearing fit. And just then, something soft fell on my ankle. From the beginning of the dramatic rendering, my pants had started to fall in slow motion, so that it seemed as if my dress was just getting longer and longer. We had to have a coffee break, but after that, for me, the Sarah Bernhardt flame was sadly extinguished. And another time, I was reporting on the Smithfield Market. When it was finished, the clerk came and said, "The chairman would like you to have this." It was a ship's carcass. I was wearing a smart light coat, wearing a little machine and a cap, and now this carcass hugged to my surprise the bosom. No car, no taxi, so it had to be a 2 minute rush hour. It stopped on the Blackfriars Bridge for ages and ages. And I was standing tightly packed against a smart city man wearing a droopy carnation. I looked up. All I said was, "Shall we dance?" And I've been stuck like that ever since. No one knows. A pool of blood was forming under my feet. The train stopped again. I got off at Sloane Square where I lived. What to do? Give it to the ticket collector? Hardly. So I struggled out, trading blood. The butcher would be shot anyway. Home I went to my maisonette around the corner, drip, drip past the Royal Court, drip, drip up the stairs and flung it in the bath. The bell rang. God, I'd forgotten that an eccentric spinster friend of mine was coming. She went up to wash, yelled and had hysterics. The four little legs reaching up at her had been too wrapped in my clothes, and begged the butcher to do what he willed.